Everyone, and we will start our workshop with just few people in the audience, but yeah, it doesn't matter. And it will be about fixing issues in your packages that fail to build on alternative architectures. So, let's start. The agenda is quite short. We will talk about the common issues that we saw in the past in the packages that we were building. We will let you know about the resources that are available for developers. Give some general directions for architecture support because with the development it can change, or with the projects. We did some work on CI for upstream projects, and yeah, can give some recommendations. We can talk about improving our documentation and see some rather complex example how to work with say complex issues where something doesn't behave as expected. So for the common issues, the most common one is about the data in DNS, which is the order of bytes read or written in memory. It depends on the architecture. Sometimes, or one of them, the most important byte is at the lowest address, and the other one is at the highest address. So this is the most common issue where projects written originally for Intel CPUs, they assume the little endian format, and without any change they can easily fail when run on big endian platforms like big endian power or the mainframe. The reasons are usually wrong typecasts when trying to get the smaller amount of or the smaller value from a bigger one, like typecasting from 4 bytes value to 1 byte, or from some 64 bits 8 bytes to 32 bits 4 bytes. In the little endian architecture, it just works because it takes the lower bytes, but it reads wrong or unexpected data when run on the bigger big endian architectures. And generally data formats for files or for storing informations in general, they either contain the definition of the endianness directly in the format, or they expect one and they need some byte swapping or value swapping functionality in reading, writing these files. Another issue that's common is that the char type in C language is by definition undecided, and the implementation of the language can decide which will be the default one. So for Intel, the default is signed, and for all other architectures it's unsigned. Can lead to strange issues when function returns -1 for Intel, but it's all ones in the byte, and when the char value is interpreted as unsigned, it's 225, and instead of for example failing or returning from a function, it does 25 cycles of some work. Another thing is about the size T type, which fortunately went away when we dropped the 32-bit mainframes from building, because it was defined there differently than on all other architectures I know about. It was a problem with C++ code where some templates couldn't deal with the size T being unsigned long, while it's usually unsigned int, so trouble there. We need some ifdefs or similar tricks in the code. Another common issue is using the atomic operations or working with atomic operations. There are various ways how to do it properly. I think the best one is using the atomics from the C and C++ languages. It's implemented in the latest or current versions of GCC, so no problems. No need to define any functions for that, usually an assembler, and usually just for view architecture, so use the standards. And similar piece is with the clocks counting or ticks counting, where some, again, per CPU architecture or architecture specific instructions are used to get these numbers, and again it requires some code in assembler. Again, often is missing for the other architectures, and if this assembler code is mandatory, there is no workaround, like using the get time of day functions or such stuff, and it just fails the builds. Other things are architecture definitions or checking what architecture is the code is being built, various ifdefs in the source code. They not always list all the architectures we care about, but yeah, that's quite simple to add the missing ones, but this should be meant as a warning whether there is some better way how to decide on which architecture it is, without requiring really explicit lists of the architectures in the source code. One warning or additional warning, there is no standard definition for the little endian power in the preprocessor defines. It needs to check first for being PowerPC architecture and then decide whether the byte order is little endian or endian. This is a proper check for designing or defining the code paths for the PPC64 begin architecture and the PPC64LE, which is the little endian version. Again, general warning about any pieces written in assembler. It goes against the portability of the code, so again, be careful and yeah, do it just when it's really necessary. Hardware support, I think it's no problem overall among ARM, naturally Intel's power, but there can be some differences on the mainframe because it's due its heritage. It's now over, I think, 50 years. It's missing some more desktop related or PC related pieces or classes of hardware like USB. There is no Wi-Fi. I don't know. There are some other pieces that are missing. And the question here is what to do about that? Whether to build, let's say, the unnecessary pieces, unnecessary libraries, and to make the packaging cleaner so there are less if arches in the spec files and they have less exceptions, or whether you want to be more precise so you will even skip building these packages. My opinion is rather to be cleaner with the packaging, reduce the number of exceptions, and rather build a few more libraries. So disk is still quite cheap even in the mainframe case, so we can accommodate these few more RPMs than if to deal with various arches and potentially broken dependencies across the architectures. So I think that most about the common issues, the parallel debugging is technique how to debug the issues that are somewhat specific to an architecture. It means that you are doing the debugging process in parallel in a, let's say, working situation and in the booking situation. And yeah, when the results will differ, then we have the wrong piece of code. Is there any question? Should I talk to the mic or? Be really short, I think, and it's meant more as a work-on session, really doing some work, so the talking part should be short, and yeah, all the information is listed here. So yeah, next part is the resources. There is a general wiki page dealing with the architectures in Fedora, which is pointers to all the architecture specific wiki pages that list some additional information. Every packager in Fedora can access the machines provided by the Fedora infrastructure team. They are Intel machines, they are 32-bit ARM machines, and both big and little endian power machines. So just we will log on with I think it's using your SSH key from FAS, and yeah, if you are in the packager group, it will just let you in. You just try, so it works. So that's the easiest option to get access. And when dealing with the endianist problems, when something is failing for big endian architectures, it usually and in most cases fails for both power and S3NTi. So the easiest way is to debug on the power machine that's really easily accessible here. There is a need for S3NTi machine specifically, just let me know, and we have one guest on public internet where any maintainer also upstreams can log in and can do their work. There are IRC channels where to find us. You can ask questions there. If there is a need for longer term for some projects, or you would like to integrate power machines into some CI or such stuff, or let's say on the upstream level, there is also an option to get virtual machines from the open power hubs that are on various places across the world. And I think either you can find them on the internet with the contacts, or we are cooperating as a Fedora alternative architecture team located in Brno, Czech Republic. We have cooperation with the University of Technology in Brno, that's hosting one of the power hubs, so yeah, we can also offer this service. Naturally, there are other ones. There is one
with
Oregon
State, and then there's
OSU, Oregon State University, and yeah, maybe there are something else as well. Yeah, and for people wanting really workstation based on alternative architecture, there is a good chance to order now the Talos workstation, which will contain the Power9 CPUs that should be generally available later this year. It's not only for working on the alternative architectures, both big and little endian power, but also it's focused on the privacy and security minded people with some additional features. Yeah, but it's probably the only alternative with reasonable performance, really to make it maybe even your primary workstation, yeah, should be doable later this year. So,
do we have any of those, or?
Sorry?
Does our infra has any of those, like Fedora infra?
In
Talos 2.
Talos 2, don't think we will have any.
We don't have any?
I will have one. I ordered mine, so.
Oh, not you,
it's
just
still
like.
Still not released. It's from
yeah.
Oh, yeah. I thought they released it very recently, or just announced it.
It's announced. It's open for pre-orders, so it's not physically available. You would have to pre-order that.
It's already released.
Not yet. And for the Fedora purposes, we have good cooperation with IBM, so they are providing us our machines directly from IBM for the various projects we have. So I think we as Fedora don't need it. I don't need to tell us, because it should be just a regular power-based machine following all the standards. So yeah, it should not make a difference there. So it's really more for the individuals who would be interested in having it at home. Yeah, so that's for the resources. Yeah, and now slightly more interesting piece. Which is the CI we are working now internally, because it's an exercise now. Definitely the plan to make it public, but what we saw in the, I think during the F26 release cycle, there were very big issues getting Firefox built with the Firefox FTSV version. They made lots of changes there. The 52 version was fine. There were some fixes from the Fedora Firefox maintainer, so it was fine, but the 53 version really was broken for a very long time for most of the architectures, including 32-bit ARM, 64-bit ARM, Power, S20, everything. So we started to think what we can do about improving the situation. And our idea was to start doing some kind of CI on the, or testing on the upstream level. And the problem or the issue here is that I don't know if most, but definitely some of the upstream projects are not interested in supporting the alternative architectures we care about in Fedora or in Red Hat in general. We want to make build everything, but since they have these architectures as the lowest level or lowest tier in their architecture or supported architecture plan, so we probably need to find or have our own infrastructure for checking these upstreams. So. Yeah, we started working on that, and I think we can show some of the results here. It's now tracking a couple projects where we know that have or had some issues in the past. We started with with the DTC, which is a device C compiler, just to learn about the Jenkins, because we picked Jenkins as the central piece. It's here just as a test project, but the first real one was the Firefox one. So difficult part in Firefox is that the Fedora packages still carry some patches that are not yet upstreamed. So you cannot take the upstream code from their Mercurial repository and just try to build it. It will fail immediately, or almost immediately. So it needs some additional patches. So that's why we split that into two steps that depend on each other. First is to prepare the Fedora sources that are patched with the Fedora specific patches. Which you, as you can see with the blue ball, it is succeeding, so it's patient able or able to apply the required federal patches. If it would fail, it would mean that the federal patches we have deteriorating or could be maybe dropped. When this task would fail, will mean that we can do something or we need to do something to get even the federal sources first. And once we have the source code for Firefox, we then do the builds. One build is with some default configuration, which is failing in general, but succeeding at least for Intel, which is a good sign. So at least one architecture is succeeding, and there are some common issues. Some of them are already reported, being worked on by the Firefox upstream. So sometime it should change directly or by using directly the Firefox code. The Firefox dash Fedora task is more closer or much more closer to the Firefox configuration in Fedora. It's using some libraries from the system, so it's really more following the style how Firefox is built in Fedora, and I guess it's failing for all architectures. It's really taking the latest upstream code. It's I think even newer than the next Firefox version, which will be 56. So, and I think there is even a branch for 57. So, it's really really the master branch. So the latest stuff that's in Firefox upstream. So yeah, it's failing. The Jenkins thing is able to put some notes to the failed build, so I've already put some reasons why the builds are failing. So yeah, it's easier to track these things when you can just check the differences between the known failure and the last failure. Sure.
So if it is pulling the master branch directly, so what spec file is it going to use?
It's not using spec files. It's using the assume instructions like configure, make install, this kind of work. It's not working with
so
spec files.
So how about the dependencies then?
It needs all dependencies installed locally on the builder or on the slave.
So
it's quite a manual action
to
get it ready.
Okay, so it's not that smart enough to figure out everything and do the build.
That's really needs a prepared machine with the dependencies pre-installed and just doing the build.
So any plans of like automating it so that like it can probably use the like in Fedora side probably can use the raw hider spec file and try to build it against it?
Yes, it could be the next step, and I think we would have to talk about the tools that are available to do that,
mm-hmm.
because this is really doing the builds natively without any mock or any kind of curious virtual machines,
mm-hmm.
anything like that. So it's really simple setup. So definitely there are some possibilities how to make it more smart and even maybe use the spec files or really the stuff directly from Fedora. I think it would be a good example to use the rebase helper tool that's available for the Fedora packages, where it really automatically creates patches for the current state of this git or the packages in this git to the latest release version. Here can be also a problem that this CI works with the master branch of upstream that's not released yet, so it's really directly talking to the Git repositories or to the Mercury repository. let's say it's open question how to improve that and or how to make it closer to the Fedora packages, but the question also is whether we want to make it closer to Fedora or closer to the upstream. So yeah, it's also question whether to follow the upstream development or the Fedora packaging, because Fedora packages are
definitely
based on
when you pull it in, like not Fedora, any other distro, definitely they will add some patches, right?
Yeah, that ideally all the stuff is in the upstreams. In Fedora, the patches are quite rare, and as we can see, for example, on the OpenBlast mass scientific library that's being built in Fedora, and this is built directly from their Git on GitHub.
Mm-hmm.
So all the stuff is already in upstream. So if the upstreams are really cooperative and accepting patches from downstreams or from the alternative architecture people across the distributions, it can really work, or these checks can really work on the highest upstream level, where the upstream is really up to date with regard to the alternative architectures. So so OpenBlast is one library that's taken directly from upstream. The libdap 4 is another one. I think with the DAP library, using the CI, it even found one issue that was not visible in the Fedora packages, because Fedora builds cannot use network connection. So there was a small number of tests or in upstream for this library. They are tests that need network connection, and this test was failing. It failed for little endian power, because there was a wrong check for block size of some caches, and it used the block size from the XFS file system, which is 64 kilobytes on power machines for whatever reason, and not the expected 4 kilobytes. So yeah, I spoke with the upstream guy, we fixed that, and now it's all fine. Any question, Mike?
Well, no, just a comment. The reason they needed that size is that it matches the page size.
Sure, yeah, that's,
But yeah, we have seen that be a problem with places.
Yeah, so that definitely was a reason to make it this way, but the upstream code was never run in this configuration, so it failed. We fixed that with upstream, and now it's green as well. Image magic is one of the recent things that got broken, so we are trying to improve that here, or at least monitor the stuff here. As I mentioned, the plan is to move all these things to public, so now the discussions will be how to share resources with some general CI Fedora infrastructure, how to share that with upstream, share with other distros, with anyone, but definitely when it will be public, much easier for anyone to check for the results. The good thing about the integration in Jenkins with the source code management tools is that it allows you to see even the direct changes in the upstream repositories. So it's then easy really to see what changed. Okay. So that's the reason why the Jenkins tool exists. Yeah, so that's it about the CI and about the plans and yeah, some other stuff. Yeah, here. What actions should be taken on packages that fail to build on alternative architectures? Our opinion is that excluding the package is really the last resort solution. We would prefer when we would be contacted first for our opinion about the stuff, unless it's clear or clear that the package doesn't make sense to be built on the particular architecture. Yeah, sometimes we can do just exclude the failing tests like we did for the image magic issues we have. So yeah, really, we would prefer not to exclude the packages if possible. So yeah, but it depends on the maintainer. It's yeah, it's their decision. Yeah. If you are looking for help, where you are looking at, shall we improve our documentation? So that's our question to us. And yeah, the last bullet here is about the stuff that's changing during the time, and it say reflects the state of the upstreams, or it can reflect the state of the upstream. The various projects, like the current development on the Go language compiler, where the PPC system for big endian part is not on par with the little endian one, and because of the missing functionality, the Go language package maintainers decided to drop the big endian power from the supported architecture. So I don't know if they make it for F26, but definitely in F27 there are no packages built that on PPC64 if they carry some going piece, or they follow the Go language guidelines and use Go Arches macro. So that's changed recently. It can happen in the future as well. It really depends on the state of the upstreams, how they support the alternative architectures, and yeah, that's that's all. What else is here? Yeah, Cine has a nice example of a complex issue that she is debugging right now, so she can give you an overview what she is doing. So Cine, please, and I think that's all from me. After that, we can do some open discussion, and yeah, we can discuss also some Orange related pieces that one might be interested in. So yeah, put it off here and yeah, let Cine talk.
Hi everyone. So this is basically an example showing how deep a problem can be. The answer could be also for the fix could be a single line, but when we while debugging, it may go deep down to multiple projects for debugging. So recently, I was debugging. I was trying to build cloud image, Fedora Cloud Atomic image on ARM v7, which is ARM SoC, and I while doing that, there is a step where Anaconda installation happened to create the image, and there was an issue which was in the storage configuration, and the error you can see, it says that volume group given physical extent size of 4 megabytes, and but it must be 1024 bit. By looking into error message, it was not quite obvious. Sorry.
Can you just increase the font size, please?
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
okay.
That's better.
Yeah. So, yeah. So by looking into error, it's not much obvious what is the problem, and it works fine on other arches. So, so I thought probably it might be arch specific issue, or maybe something else you don't know in the beginning. So, I will tell you what approach I took. Since it was a problem in Anaconda installation, so I opened the Anaconda source code, and I looked for the error message, which could be like the text string match, which could be volume group given physical extent, something like that. And I found that in Anaconda Anaconda file called kickstart.py. So this is the first step. Yeah. Yeah, so you can see that there is a line called LVM group device volume group device or gets supported PE sizes. So so it basically calls and gets the physical supported sizes here, and it's returning basically 1024 bit, and the Anaconda needs the physical extent size of 4, expecting the default, which is used as 4 megabytes. And I opened the Python interpreter and tried to reproduce it on the machine, and tried to reproduce on ARM and both x86-64 to see what basically the results is here. So what I saw, that the result obtained is on ARM HFP, it was just 1024 bit. It basically returns a list of sizes starting from 1024 bit to 16 gigabit on other arches, x86-64 or ARC64 or power arches. So it seems to me like it's not getting expected results because it's only 1024 bit returning on ARM, or it might be that that's the only supported physical extent size on ARM. So I wasn't sure at that time. So what I did was later I went. I have to go deep on that, from where exactly this information is coming. So basically, the second step, which is it basically calls from, it's basically a call from Bleavit package. So I went there. So there is also just they're making call to blogdev.lvm.getsupportedpesizes. So this is the function which they call. So obviously here is not the definition of what exactly it's getting returned. So next step was it's basically coming from block dev module, and so I need to look there. It might be the definition is there. So I took a guess that where might be this module, because it's not a Python module. So there is a libblock dev package. That package is surprisingly in C. So obviously it's not now in Python. So now you can see that the code flow is going from Python to C. So it's basically libblock dev provides us some functions which can be used in which basically can be used in other languages. So in Python they were using those functions. So the way of using those functions is basically in libblock dev is there is a file which gets generated called blockdev.2.0.typelib. So typelib is a kind of another file format, and which is basically can be read by G object introspection, which is another project. So it's a binary format which is read by them, and so you can basically get back the what exactly is defined in this typelib file, and there is a binary given by G object introspection which is called this GIR generate, which will generate an XML file from the typelib. Okay, so when I open the XML file, you will see that this is the function name, LLVM get supported PE sizes, which you can see that in the Python the blivit package, it's calling that lvm.getSupportedPEsizes. So that's the function which Python should be calling, and it's basically mapped in the C function as bd underscore lvm dot underscore get supported PE sizes, and it says array 0 terminated equal to 1. So I will tell you later. So what happened that so these are the things which I understood while debugging the code, that okay, that's how they are sending back the data from Python to C to Python. This was not just standard C Python used. It was like it uses the GI and it gets understanding from how type reads from the typelib, etc. And yeah, the return type of the function is GUint64, which is like 8-byte in sizes. So later, what I did was I went to this function in C, which is bd underscore lvm get supported PE sizes. I did the debug print statement there to see what basically it's returning the data on ARM and on other arches as well. So I took x86-64 as the example. So in both arches, this function was basically returning the right data. And this returns exactly the same list, which is 1024-bit to 16 gigabit. So basically it's the multiple of two from 1024-bit to next will be 2048-bit. And etc. So till 16 gigabit. So now I know that it's not a problem. It's not something that it's not the ARM v7 doesn't support other physical extent sizes other than 1024 bit. It basically supports, but there is some problem happening while returning the data from C to Python back, which might be. Which is basically happening only on ARM v7 or maybe some other 32-bit arches as well, because I'm only debugging on ARM v7 and there are either i686, so I'm not using that for now. So I can just say that it might be 32-bit issue. Okay, so now I know that libblockdev returns right data. Now I have to know how exactly it communicates, the Python and C both communicates to each other. So there is another project which is called PyGObject3, which contains which basically has a function called FFI call, And this function, interestingly, at the runtime, it gets the function name and it calls the function with the matching function name. It will probably look into the tightly information and it will call the function if it matches, and it makes call to the libblock defined function. And so most of the places it's fine, and now still I haven't went to where exactly it's returning data. So there was another file in PyG object 3 which basically returns data which can be returned to Python, which the function looks like this. This is the function which is called static py object star underscore this true py array. So there are various other functions as well, but this is what gets returned in our case. So this is the standard way of returning the data to Python. It's like py object star, and it will map back to the Python data types, which whatever data types and gets other understandings are there. So I reached at this point, so you can see that I have to go into various projects to understand where the problem could be. I'm still struggling. I know the flow and where can be the problem, but still what exactly is the problem is still in progress, and I hope I will get the answer soon. So far from my experience, it seems like the problem is the type being used. So they have various data types used, which is like depending upon arches, like unsigned long. When I do the size of on arc 64 or x86 or any other 64 bit arches, it gives me 8 byte of size. But on arm v7, it gives me 4 byte of sizes. So and there are a lot of data types being used, which is basically defined in glib2 library, which has the definitions which uses other primitive standard data types and doing the type diff. So there are basically a lot of type diffs, and some are architecture specific, which might change. So I am looking into various possible options. So the fix might be a single line, but yes, debugging may take you from one project to a lot of other projects on which it depends. So this was my current experience with debugging this issue.
Thanks, and it really shows.
Just wanted to share the information how you can debug like various issues which might be an arc specific. There are indigenous issue, and there might be the 32 or 64 bit arc specific issues too. There might be an issue which only happening on just one architecture. Like recently we had PPC 64LE rebuild on due to some changes added in the PPC 64LE glibc.
Yeah, so I think that we already were out.
Is this bug fixed already or okay?
No, I said I'm working on it. This is the recent problem I encountered, and it's really taking me time because I have to understand how exactly these all flows are happening. Never debugged this kind of issue before, so understanding
it. I think that we already.
Good and interesting thing is that you cannot use GDB or something which can give you trace from Python to C function call. So you just only can debug Python, and then if you're going to C, you need to use you don't know basically how exactly the flow works. It DDB doesn't give me the results. So it's really like going and doing print statement or something like that, whatever understanding is there to use that.
So thanks,
and
it's really, I think it's really nice example of a complex issue that needs to be developed. It might be worth to try it on certificate Intel because it's more related to the long type. It should behave the same, so there might be some wrong definition in between or the interface between the C library and the Python library, where they would not understand correctly the types and would really return the one value for the certificate Intel maybe. So. Yeah, but I think it really showed the flow of between the projects and all the stuff that needs to be debugged. And so I think covers most of the workshop.
We were expecting to get some issues if people have.
Yeah,
so
really the idea was that there could be some people having some issues. So. Do you have something to show, or do you want to really help with? Unfortunately, not many people came here, so we cannot help them. There is one thing that I forgot, because I want to publicly thank to Jerry James, who is a federal maintainer for a long time, who did some fixes for big internet issues in various packages, even when our initial discussion was, okay, upstream doesn't take care about, for example, mainframe, they just ignore that. He was leaning to putting an exclude arch, and I don't know, 1 week later I saw a patch from him, federal package. Just being that he got the fix, so he's I think a really good guy in fixing really obscure issues related to the beginning architectures in general. So I think we will find some way how to thank him more publicly. So, so really shows the nice part of being or doing collaboratively on the distribution, that someone is really picking quite hard task to fix it. Maybe he likes challenges, I don't know. Because, or he doesn't like when packages are failing for some architectures. But yeah, I think our goal in general is really to make all packages available on all architectures if it's technically possible, so anyone can pick his favorite architecture. And there are reasons why people are still using mainframe. So.
So if we have some time, I'd like to ask, is Fedora actually running on any big Indian architecture?
Yeah, it's running on mainframes, so it's running the X architecture. It's, still big Endian, and I don't think it will change.
Any specific example? Can you tell which architecture? So is it mainframe? Which mainframe?
There is only one. It's IBM mainframe. The system Z or Z systems.
It's
on the 64 bit. And the shortcut and UPC 64, the big Endian power. The original power architecture is still supported in Fedora and
UPC64, or I think it's going out with the 27, 28. We are going to only support little engine going forward.
So it depends what you define by support. It definitely will be the little engine will be the priority, and we will try to keep the beginning running if it's possible.
Okay. I thought that we are totally trying to remove it.
No, we are not actively trying to remove it, but there will be time where we will be